Well, today is a special day, folks. Today is a special day because it is the day that the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. Whew! Boy, do I got some stuff to share with y'all today. You already know it's gonna be something when the title of the sermon is unmasked. Ooh. But that's what it's gonna be. Now, what Tony started, I'll finish, and we'll just blame Tony at the end, okay? Look, the Bible says that the word of the Lord is sharper than a double-edged sword. All of it is beneficial, or all of it is prosperous to us for our, what is it? For our encouraging and for our discipline, huh? Correction and discipline. Yeah? Yes. Cool, man, all right. So if we got our masks, we can put, no, I'm just joking. But look, my sermon is titled Unmasked. And I hate this thing. Actually, I don't wear it anyway. But this one smells like gum. It's been in my car next to the gum packs for a while. Don't take a picture of that. That's awful. Look. When all of this started, and the first lockdown happened, I don't know if you guys remember, they said 2 weeks to flatten the curve. And I remember this feeling of like rebellion rising up in me. Oh no, I'm not staying home. And I remember my neighbors were bunkered down and they're like looking out the windows and we have like people over like so many cars. I remember during those 2 weeks, I'm like, man, I think somebody's gonna call the cops on us because we have this lockdown and we kept having people over, like dozens of people at my house. It was like a party every day, every other day. And I'm like, great, cool. We're gonna get called. I mean, I used to close the curtains. I was like, I'm rebelling. I'm gonna beat this thing, you know? They don't got a hold on me. And then when it went to masks, I remember a feeling of like anger. When it went to lockdowns again and restaurants closing and all that, I went to disappointment. Remember I had a moment of fear with my job. I remember disliking people of the opposite political spectrum, hating. It's a harsh word, but like really hating the rhetoric. I remember going through this range of emotions. Can anybody relate? people, Karens walk up to me at stores and I give them a piece of my mind and they, you know, turn the other way, walk away. Like, I'm like, call the manager, see what happens. The manager's coming, like, what's up? They're like, you're fine, do whatever you want. And as time went on, as 1 year turned to 2 years, and we're coming up to 2 years of rhetoric, I sat before God and I said, God, why? God, why? I can keep fighting this in my own solo army of Alex and my wife, you know, going places to, you know, make people mad. I was just like, I don't care what you, you know, you can ask me, but that's fine. So, because I like refuse to wear it. So that's my thing. I'm like, I'm not gonna wear it. I won't patron your business if you make me wear it. So I'll just go somewhere else. We were in Leavenworth yesterday and when we'd walk in, if they said anything, we just went to the next one. We spent our money elsewhere. But I remember sitting and saying, God, why? Why is this happening? Why is it happening? God, why? Why now? Why at all? Why are these people in power? Why? Why? The Bible says, the authorities that exist have been appointed by God. That's in Romans. The authorities that exist in power have been appointed by God. You're saying it was stolen. I don't, you know, whatever your opinion is, don't matter. Maybe it was stolen, maybe it was given by God. Another scripture says in Daniel 2, God controls the course of the world events. We're in a world event. He controls the course of the world events. He removes kings and sets up other kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the scholars. Who's in control? Who's in control of all of this? Who's in control of the madness? God. And that made me ask why even louder. I said, God, why? I mean, I'd be driving alone and I'm like, God, why? Why? I'm so frustrated. I'm so tired of it. I'm so sick of it. I want to move out. I want to go somewhere else. I want to run. I want to hide. I want to get away from this. God, why? On multiple occasions, I woke up in the middle of the night. And on multiple occasions, God spoke to me. On one occasion, I woke up at 4 in the morning and I heard the word Molech. Molech. And man, I'm like, Molech, that's like a demon. I'm like, Lord, cast out all demons. Molech, Molech. Well, did you know that since the inception of Roe versus Wade, that court ruling, 60 million children have been murdered in America alone at the hands of doctors, at the hands of mothers. Molech. You say, well, that's not child, because Molech is the idol, is the god of child sacrifice in the Old Testament, if you didn't know that. Molech. I'm sitting there thinking, God, but that's not. But it is. It's murder at the hands of our nation. God, why? Why all the shutdowns? Why have you muzzled us? Homosexuality is not just rampant in America. Homosexuality has come into the schools where they're teaching children that they get to choose their gender, not what God created them to be, but these confused, tiny children are being told lies. My question, to me, to you, is where is the church? Well, politics aren't for the church. Where is the church? If you won't talk about the things that matter to God, then maybe God will shut your mouth. Then maybe God will throw a mask on it. You weren't talking anyway. Maybe a mask is exactly what we need. Maybe to stay home and away from work is exactly what we need. The Bible says that God did many miracles when the Israelites left slavery, when they left Egypt. They came to the Red Sea. What'd they do? First thing, they grumbled. They complained. You've brought us to the Red Sea to die. Mind you, this is like 2 million people. This isn't like a couple thousand people like, no. This is like 2 million people followed Moses because Moses followed God. They came to the Red Sea, backs up against it, said, let's go back. Let's go back to slavery. Let's go back to our sin. Grumbling. They crossed the Red Sea. They rejoiced for a day. Miraculously crossed the Red Sea on dry ground, the Bible says. They rejoiced for one day. They make a song about it. dancing, singing, rejoicing. Our God is powerful. 3 days later, they're complaining. Grumbling before God. God makes water come from a rock. From a rock. A little bit of time goes by. You know the trip? I'll tell you something. The trip from Egypt to Jericho was like 2 weeks walking. Why'd it take them 40 years? They grumbled nonstop. 10 major miracles happened. They wanted food, God gave them manna. They wanted meat, God gave them quail. Would fly in every day. You hungry? You hungry? And they grumbled. Their sandals didn't even wear out, and they grumbled. And they grumbled, and they grumbled, and they grumbled, and they grumbled, and then they finally came to the promised land, and God still was merciful. And God was patient, and God was slow to anger. And then they came to the promised land, and they sent in 12 messengers, one from each tribe of Israel, 12 spies, to go and see the promised land. They came back, and they're like, man, it's a land flowing of milk and honey. It's prosperous. There's cattle, there's berries, there's grapes. It's just whatever you can imagine. A prosperous land. And what happened? Who knows? They grumbled and they refused God. You know what they did? Let me tell you what they did. Let me read it for you. Numbers chapter 14. Verse 1, that night, all the members of the community raised up their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt. God brought them to the promised land, and they're like, man, if only we would have just lived in our sin, we didn't experience Christianity, we wouldn't have the circumstances that we have. We should have just lived in our sin and died. That's the parallel, right? I'm drawing this parallel between our lives and theirs. The whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. Why is it that the Lord has brought us to this land only to let us fall by sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should find a leader to take us back. You want to know what that looks like? You do. Here's what it looks like. You preachers are preaching too much truth. Let me find another pastor. Let me find another leader, somebody who's gonna tickle my ears and tell me that God just wants me to be prosperous. I'm tired of Moses. I'm tired of Aaron. I'm tired of them telling us that we're gonna have to go fight the good fight to go conquer territory for the Lord. Give me something that I wanna hear. Tell me how much God loves me. Again? God loves you. You want to hear it again? Yes. God hates sin. Oh, you don't want to hear it? Any sin in your life separates you from God and you're damned to hell. Oh, you don't want to hear it? Because that's what happened in the church. They sold out God for money. They sold out God for prosperity. So maybe, just maybe, God slapped these masks on our faces so we can remember God. Anybody with me? They say, let's go back. Let's go back to our sin. Tired of these preachers saying, drinking's not good. Tired of these preachers saying, can't sleep around on my wife. You know what? There's entire movements and entire churches where all of that's okay. I'm tired of preachers telling me that sin is sin. I'm tired of preachers saying that homosexuality is a sin. I'm tired of preachers saying divorce is a sin. I'm tired of preachers that preach the truth. Well, then you know what? Find ourselves a new preacher. Find ourselves a new teacher. Find ourselves a new church. This church ain't good enough for me. They don't serve me enough. They don't give me enough. I want a better worship team, even though ours is the best. I'm just talking about the unfaithfuls up in the church. And you guys know that when I refer to church, I mean the body of Christ. Those who call themselves Christians. The kids ministry isn't good enough. The teens ministry ain't good enough. The preacher sucks. He yells a lot. Give us a new one. And you know what they said? Moses and Aaron fell face down in front of the whole Israelite assembly and gathered there. Joshua, son of Nun, Caleb, son of Jephunneh, were there among those who explored the land. They tore their clothes and said to the entire assembly, "The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us up into the land, a land flowing of milk and honey, and it will be us, and it will be given to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord. And do not be afraid of the people in this land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them." God is for us. Who can be against us? And here's how they responded. Boy, if you haven't read the Old Testament in a while, it's a good read. "But the whole assembly talked about stoning them to death." And preach the good news. Preach the gospel. If they want to stone you, you're doing the right thing. The Bible says that the gospel is offensive. It's offensive. And if you read it, you should be offended. You should be. You'd be like, "Oh, snap, I'm in sin. I better go repent. Oh, maybe I should stop doing that." The Bible says, "Go and sin no more." "Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all the Israelites. The Lord said to Moses, 'How long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe me in spite of all the signs I have performed for them? I will strike them down with a plague and destroy them, but I will make you into a nation greater and stronger than they.'" Now, how many of you know that God don't joke? God's not playing. That was the plan. You're saying, "But that's not what happened." I know. Because God will change the course of humanity, the course of history for our sake. It's true. Moses prayed on behalf of the whole community. And God forgave him. He said, "I'll forgive them, but they're not going into the promised land. And neither are you, Moses. Only Joshua and Caleb and everybody under the age of 20. We live in a land of prosperity. We have 4% of the world population lives in America. You know, trust me, I know that they're just reported numbers, but we have the highest cases we have the highest reported cases of COVID. We have the highest death counts in the whole world. While India has like a fifth of the world's population, and they beat it. Believe the numbers or not, it doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. But here's the point. Those who grumble all the time, maybe those are the ones that God is bringing low. Those who are constantly complaining, look, what do you and I have to complain about in America? What do you and I have to complain about? Our food? Look, man, I don't struggle with what food to eat. Like, I can find whatever I want. We're living in prosperity. I'm like trying not to eat as much food, okay? Let's be real. Like, control that. My eyes like that, and then they like that. Is it the clothes we wear? You don't have enough clothes? Complaining, "God, I want better clothes. Give me finer things and designer things." Is it the jobs we have? Constantly complaining. "Oh, well, this one ain't good enough either." God's like, "You just moved from job to job to job. None of them's good enough." Constantly complaining. "God, why? My spouse ain't good enough. God, why? Your house ain't big enough. I want a bigger one. You have health? Man, they made metaverse so you can live eternally. You think I'm playing? Gonna upload your character, upload your traits, and you can pass away, but you'll remain in the metaverse. We have wealth, but it's never enough. We have a church, but we constantly complain about it. You know, I heard a good thing said by my friend the other day. He said, I'm not leaving this church. He said, what we ought to do is change the problems that we see. You see a problem, you see a shortcoming, well, they don't have enough kids at, you know, they don't have enough people in the kids ministry. Maybe God's calling you. Youth ministry is too small. Start sending your kids. We need better preachers. Start praying for the preachers. We need better teachers. Start praying for the teachers. We need better leadership. Start praying for that leadership. We have shortcomings. I know. But let me tell you something. There's no such thing as a perfect church. I've been to many churches. I've visited many a church. And if you ask people, they're always going to tell you something wrong. It's always something wrong. I don't care whose church you've been to and where you're from. It's not good enough. So God shut down churches, God shut down jobs, God shut down restaurants. And then maybe then we can reflect on, man, just going to church was nice. Ah, just being able to have somebody else cook for me, that was a blessing. Having somebody teach my children, that was great. Oh yeah, schools. Our kid isn't of school age, so they shut down schools. Let me tell you something. God is in control. And here's what the Bible says. Here's how we recoup and regroup as the body of Christ. While the Israelites were building an idol, okay, they made a golden calf. Everybody mocks that golden calf, but honestly, they were just trying to build themselves a God. And they didn't know what God looked like. So they were like, cows are pretty great. Very necessary in the desert. You get milk and meat. So maybe God is a cow. And they start making a golden cow. And I know it's funny. I used to think that's the dumbest thing in the world. But how many of us are making our own golden cows? We don't like the way God looks. We don't like the calling on our lives. We don't like where God is calling us to. We don't like to serve God with our wealth, our health, our time. So we're like, you know what? I'm gonna build a God that looks like this, that fits my own image and my own likeness, that serves my own selfish needs. Because you know one thing that I really dislike is when people say, I don't got time. We have the same amount of time. 23 point some hours in the day. Round it up to 24. We all got the same amount of time. You choose to do what you want to do. I remember before the pandemic, people were like, got one job, another job, like two jobs, 16 hours a day, plus a side hustle. And they're like, I can't make it to church. I'm busy. I'm like, duh. Because you're serving your God. His name is Mamona. That's his name. It's idolatry. The Bible says you can only have one master. You'll either love one and hate the other. You'll despise one and love the other. You can either serve God or money. This is a sermon about money? No. I'm just saying that we've built our own gods that reflect our own desires. So don't mock the Israelites. You know what Moses did? He went up to the mountain to pray. And at this time, in our walk of faith, I believe that's where God is calling us to. God is calling us as a church, as a people, as those who call themselves Christians, to go to the mountain and pray. What does that mean? It means to go find the face of God. Go get to know God. not the image that you created for your life, not the constant grumbling, oh God, this ain't good and that ain't good. No, go get to know God. And the Bible says that Moses came down and he was just different from all the rest of them because he got to know God. Church, when we get to know God, our priorities change. We become different. We're not trying to be as good as the Joneses or the people next door. The Bible says, where does your anger come from? Your fits of rage and jealousy, where do they come from? It says, I'm paraphrasing, but it says it comes from the desires of the things that you don't have that you see your neighbor has. And so they cause you to kill, steal. James. God is calling us to the mountain. God is calling us to be with him. God is calling us to get to know Jesus Christ. The Bible says that use your wealth on this earth to win souls to heaven so that when you're in heaven, you'll be invited into many homes. I don't know what your image of heaven is, but to me, there's homes. And let me tell you something. When I die, people are like, my legacy. I'm like, I don't care about my legacy. I want to leave an inheritance for my children. Sure, that's fine. That's biblical. I don't care about my legacy. Oh, Alex, he was a nice guy. He preached. No, I want it to be like, that guy was a bit aggressive. He was a bit offensive, but Jesus saved my life. That's all I want. And because then when I get to heaven and I stand before God, and if God says to me, well done, good and faithful servant, you had a task and you did it. Here you go, enter my rest. And look, I'm gonna walk in. It's gonna be like, hey bro, come over for some tea. Remember that one time when you told me the truth and we were at work and you know and you told me about Jesus and I told you to shut up? Well, guess what? I went home and I got saved. Woo! Remember that one time we were at the grocery store and you always nudged me and said, hey man, you been to church? You know, I never went to church. But eventually I started thinking of, well, maybe there is something at this church. Can you imagine if we lived our life according to God's purpose and God's plan for us? If we didn't worry about this tiny snippet of time that we're living in right now, but instead we focused on the eternity. I don't care what my legacy is here on earth. I care what my future is in eternity. Dear church, God's calling us back to himself. I believe that God allowed these things to happen because God is calling us back to himself. God wants us to be his people. Not a people divided by the lust for things. Not a people divided by a passion for things that don't matter to God. But a people who love one another. A people who can serve each other. And here's the solution to our problem. The Bible said, Solomon built a temple. Solomon built a temple and God showed up and he said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. God only allows things like this to happen when he wants us to repent, when he's trying to get our attention. Hey, look over here. I have something for you. Quit chasing the nuggets on the ground. Look what I got for you. I have something greater. I have something greater than the things on this earth. I have eternity. I have peace, joy, righteousness. I can give you a good night's rest. I can give you some joy. I can give you love between your spouse. God is holding and he's like here. And you're like, no. I see this thing right here and I'm gonna go and I'm gonna flip up this carpet. I saw Penny. God's like, I got it all. It's not in the quantity things of the things you possess. It's in how you hold the things that you do possess. We need to stop looking God as some kind of a genie. And we need to start looking God as God as God. God's not here to hear our grumbling. You know, he'll answer. because he's gracious and he's kind. He'll answer our grumbling. But I think that time has run its course. And God is calling Christendom, the world, all of it back to himself. There'll be those who stand, but there'll be those who don't. God is looking for sincere believers, sincere servants. They used to have to go and sacrifice at the temple, but now the Bible says that God has made us that temple, the temple of the Holy Spirit. God is looking for Calebs and Joshuas, guys and gals that'll go against the flow. Guys, men and women who are committed to God, men and women who believe in the promise of God, men and women who are not afraid to pray in tongues. It's become unpopular to see the move of the Holy Spirit. Why? It's the most powerful force. Why has it become so, don't pray in tongues. That's offensive to me. Don't pray for healing. Don't cast out demons. Maybe somebody will see it. That's offensive to me. Do you know Jesus spent 70% of his ministry? They said he did over 10,000 miracles, and 7,000 of those or more were spent on casting out demons. Why are we so ashamed of the move of God? Forget eloquent words. Forget eloquent speech. Paul was a crazy scholar, knew the books of the Bible, knew everything, okay? He said, I don't come at you with eloquent speech, but I come with you with the power and the might of the Holy Ghost. There's a simple doctrine, and God's not hiding. Please don't believe that God is mysterious. God is not. God is not mysterious. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit reveals all things to us. Go find your mountain with God. Go spend some time with God. Go get to know God. Moses spent 40 days up there. Maybe it'll take you 4 hours. Maybe it'll take you 4 days. Maybe it'll take you 40 days. I don't know. But God is willing and God is wanting to show up in your life. The Bible says that the veil is torn. There's nothing that separates us between God. We don't need a mediator. You don't need me. You think you need me to pray for you? Oh, I'll pray for you. And I believe God will heal you. I believe God will save you. I believe God will cast demons out of you. I believe God will cast demons off of you. I believe it. But you don't need me. You don't need my faith. The veil is torn, and there's no mediator between God and man except for Jesus Christ himself. And we go to Jesus and we receive. And the Holy Spirit speaks on our behalf. When we don't know what to pray for, we pray in tongues. It says it's a grumbling that where the Holy Spirit prays for us on our behalf. Unashamed. Church, can we be unashamed? Church, can we open our mouths for defenseless children? Can we open our mouths with prayers, with praise and thanksgiving instead of grumbling? Constantly grumbling. Nothing is good enough. Stop it. Stop it. And you know what? If we start praising God, maybe he'll slap these stupid masks off our faces. Sooner than later, because God is a merciful God. And even though God wanted to destroy the whole Israelites, the whole nation, and start over with Moses, God is merciful. As soon as we come back, as soon as we pray, as soon as we repent, God says, I'll heal it. I'll heal the land. I'll take away these ruthless rulers, these tyrants. Why have they risen up all over the earth? Why? Because God allowed it. And you know what I need? I need Jesus. That's it. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Stand with me. I'm gonna read one more thing to you. Before he died, Muhammad said, I don't know the purpose of life. Before he died, Buddha said, seek for the truth. I'm not the truth. Before Confucius died, he said, I am not the way. Before Jesus died, he said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And nobody comes to the Father except through me. And he died, and he rose. And he's the only one who rose from the grave. And you know what? He spent 40 days on earth appearing to the disciples and 500 other people. There are testimonies of it written in history that the man who they crucified then walked among them. And then hundreds of people saw him ascend physically to heaven. Come on, that's the God we serve, church. Yes. Whew. I'm about to have a praise break up in here. That's the God we serve. That's the God who's calling us. No more grumbling. No more of that. Say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your provision. Thank you for the way. Thank you for showing me a future. Thank you for giving me friends. Thank you for giving me a family. Thank you for giving me food. Thank you for giving me a home. You're my provider. And I'll walk into that promised land. I'll walk into, you know what your promised land is? Can I tell you? This is a good one. It's the calling that God has on your life. Everything that God prepares you for, it's to live out your calling on your life. And that's to conquer territory for God. It's to live like Jesus, to live, look like Jesus, and conquer territory for God. You understand? They went into the promised land and they conquered that territory for God. God will empower you. God will bless you. God will give everything, all your heart's desires. The Bible says that God knows our heart's desires and that he gives us exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or even think to ask for. Church, God is not a cruel God. He's a good God. He's a kind God. It's true. But he's also righteous, and he can't put up with sin, and he can't put up with 50-50 Christianity, lukewarm Christianity, because I'll tell you what, lukewarm Christianity is straight to hell. It's not Christianity. It's fake. It's a farce. So as we pray, I want you to come before your God, my God, Jesus Christ, the creator of heaven and earth, the God of the universe. Repent, get right, and change your life. Change the direction. You're like, well, that's hard. With God, it's all things are possible, folks. Father, I thank you. God, I thank you that we can come before you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for dying on the cross for our sins. Father, I thank you for forgiveness. God, I thank you for the truth of your word. Jesus, we come before you as a church. My God, we come before you humbly, Jesus. Father, we pray, my God, that you would forgive us, Lord. Lord, forgive us for our grumbling. God, forgive us for our ungratefulness, Lord. Forgive our sin, Jesus. Help us, Lord, to walk in step with you. You're the way, the truth, and the life, Lord. And we thank you for all that you've done. If we could all bow our heads and close our eyes, we're gonna say a quick prayer. Just bow your heads and close your eyes. If you're in this place and you wanna get right with God, you're saying, I need forgiveness for my sins, just raise your hand real quick. 1, 2, 3. Thank you. Who else? You're saying, I need to get right with God. Thank you. Who else? You're saying, I need forgiveness for my sins. Quickly. Can we all pray this prayer together? Whether you raised your hand or not, can we pray this prayer together? Jesus Christ, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I believe that you came to this earth, died on the cross for my sins, and rose again on the third day. I give my life to you. And from this day forward, I'm yours. In Jesus' name. Amen.